Okay, I hope you can hear me.
Yes.
Okay, so thank you very much for the invitation. And yes, today I would like to talk about random constraint satisfaction problems and the effect of introducing a bias in the measure that describes the set of solutions. So this is the outline. I start by giving some definition and introducing the phase transition, some of the phase transition that arise in this random constraint satisfaction problems. Then I define the bias measure that we have studied and its effect on the clustering transition. And then I look at the particular case of the large K limit, where K is the number of variables involved in one clause. Okay, so for the definition, so a constraint satisfaction problem, so it can be seen as a set of n discrete variables that are subjected to a set of m constraints, and the solution is an assignment of the variables so that all the constraints are satisfied. And in this talk, I will focus on one particular problem, which is the bicoloring on the K hypergraph. And an instance is defined as follows, so it's an hypergraph of n vertices. And M hyperedges, where an hyperedge links a subset of K variables. And on the vertices lies the spin variables. So there are Boolean, or here I take the notation of spin variables. And okay, a solution is an assignment of all these spin variables so that all the constraints are satisfied, where a constraint is that the K variable involved in one hyperedge shouldn't be all equal. So there is at least one variable that is plus one and one variable that is minus one. Okay, and it's, so in order to study the typical properties of this problem, it's interesting to introduce random ensemble of instances. And so here it's a random ensemble of K hypergraphs. So here I will talk about two main ensemble, common ensemble, which are the regular ensemble in which the vertices of the degree of the vertices are fixed, and the Hardoche-Renyi ensemble. And okay, and see, so it's very interesting to look at the thermodynamic limit, where you send the number of variable and the number of constraint to infinity, but at a fixed ratio alpha, which is so the density of constraints. And so when you increase the value of alpha in this thermodynamic limit, you will see that the set of solution will undergo several phase transition that I've tried to describe here. So the squares represent the space of configuration, and the black region corresponds to the set of solution. So the most prominent phase transition is the satisfiability transition, above which typical instances in the large thermodynamic limit doesn't admit solution, and below there is solution. And in this talk, I will focus on the clustering transition, which can be defined in several ways. So the first one, it's from, you can see it from this sketch. So below the clustering transition, the set of solution is rather well connected, and you can reach any solution from the other one by making a small rearrangement of a small number of variables. And above, the solution set split into an exponential number of clusters. And this cluster are separated by free energy barriers. Okay, and it can also be defined as follows. So when you run a Monte Carlo Markov chain to sample the set of solution, above the clustering transition, it will have an exponential relaxation time, while below, it will be able to equilibrate in a polynomial time in N. And finally, it's also related to the apparition of long-range correlations, which are called the point-to-set correlation, that measure the correlation between one point and the set of variables that are at distance d from it. And this is related to an information theoretic problem called the reconstruction on K hypertrees in this problem. Okay, so what is interesting to look at is to look at the typical properties of the algorithm that try to find a solution on the typical instances. So can we relate their typical performances to one of the phase transitions that I've mentioned? And is there a barrier above which a value of the density of constraint above which it's not possible to design an algorithm that would find a solution in a polynomial time? So in order to understand this, okay, we have to look at different regimes. So in the regime of small k, actually there is some algorithm that are very efficient and that can find a solution in polynomial time up to density of constraints that are very, very close to the satisfiability threshold. But in the large K limit, so the situation is quite different. And up to now, the best algorithm can find an efficiently solution up to density of constraints that are at the leading order, the same as the clustering transition. So here I give the scaling for the clustering transition. It's 2 to the k minus 1 log k over k. And this has to be compared with the satisfiability transition, which scales as 2 to the k minus 1 log 2. So between these two values, there is a wide range of alpha in which typical solution, typical instances do admit a solution. But up to now, we don't know any algorithm that are probably efficient in this range. Okay, so now here is the approach that we have adopted. So all the many of the phase transitions that I have mentioned, and in particular the clustering transition, they are obtained for the uniform measure over the set of solutions. So this is its expression that gives a zero weight when the configuration is not a solution, and it gives the same weight for all the configurations that are solutions. And if you instead you introduce a non-uniform measure that still gives a zero weight to configurations that are not solutions but weight differently the solutions, then you will be able to move the value of the clustering threshold, but not the value of the satisfiability threshold. And so the goal is to design a biased measure so that we can increase the value of the clustering threshold. And we have seen that at least for the performance, so for the simulated annealing algorithm, it will increase its performances. So there is some work that have been that have used this this idea of biasing the measure. So in the first example, it's on the problem of packing hard spheres, which can be seen as a constraint satisfaction problem. On the second item is the solutions are weighted according to their number of frozen variables. And on the third item, so the solutions are weighted according to their local entropy, which was introduced in the previous talk by Carlo Lucibello. And so here I define the bias that we have studied. So the first one introduces interaction inside that factorize on the clause. So this is the expression of the measure that we have used. And so it's a product over the constraints. And it's defined through this function omega that takes as argument the set of k variables involving one constraint. So it gives still a zero weight to the configuration that violates the constraints. So when all the spins are equal to either plus one or minus one. Otherwise, it gives a non-zero weight. But through this parameter epsilon, it will give a different weight according to the number of almost violating clauses. So this equality means that there is only one spin that takes the opposite value compared to the other variable involved in this clause. And okay, this is a second example. So there we introduce some interaction at distance one. So this is an example of a small K hypergraph with K equal three. So the vertices are represented by black dots and the hyperedge are represented by white squares. And so K equal three in this. And okay, so the bias that we study, it will introduce interaction between one variable and its neighbors at the distance one. Okay, and we have chosen this bias to count the number of forcing clauses. Where a forcing clause, so let's say that A is a forcing clause, this means that the variables that are surrounding it, except I, are all equal, and this will force the variable I to take the opposite value so that the constraint is well satisfied. And so this takes this following form, where P is the number of forcing clauses. Okay. So now this is the result that we have obtained for a finite K. So this is the clustering threshold for a random regular graph. So where the degree is fixed and is related to alpha through this relation. And so we have computed the clustering threshold for K equal 5 and 6. So this is the value of the clustering threshold in the second column for the uniform case. And you can see that when you optimize on the parameter that describe the bias of the first and the second bias, you are able to increase indeed the value of the clustering threshold. And we checked that this has a positive effect on the simulated annealing algorithm. Okay, so now I move to the last part that look at the large K limit of the clustering transition. So in the large K limit, the clustering transition has this following asymptotic expansion. So what is known rigorously about this asymptotic expansion? So the dominant term has been proven for the bicoloring of K hypergraphs, as well as other constraint satisfaction problems, such that, for instance, the Q coloring problem, in which the variable can take this time Q value. And also, there is some result about the third term. So the by these two papers by Alan Sly and Zhang about so some inequalities on the third term, the constant term gamma d. And so we, with my advisor, Guillaume Semergian, we have estimated the value of this constant. And we have shown that it was the same for both for the problem of bicoloring on K-hypergraphs graphs and for the problem of Q-coloring. And so now what is interesting is to look at the effect of the bias that we have introduced on this asymptotic expansion of the clustering threshold. So for this, we need to choose a scaling for the parameter that describes the bias. So for the intra-close bias, we took this scaling that epsilon scales at a constant over a square root of k log k. And so tilde epsilon is now our rescaled bias parameter. And for the interaction at distance one, we have taken a specific choice where we distinguish between the case where there is p equals zero, so there is no forcing clauses, from the case where there is at least one forcing clauses. And b is our bias parameter that we take constant as case growing. So with this choice of scaling, we showed that the clustering transition arises at the same scale as the uniform case. But now we can make some improvement on the third term of the expansion. So gamma d depends now on the bias parameter epsilon and tilde epsilon and b. So okay, this is the result for the intra-close bias. So this is a plot of the rescale parameter tilde epsilon square against gamma d. And the dots represent the clustering transition. So the uniform case corresponds to tilde epsilon equal to zero. And so you can see from this plot that as long as you turn on the bias, you decrease actually the value of the clustering threshold. So this is not what we expect. We would like to have a bias that increases the clustering threshold. So with this bias, it's not doable. But instead, with the bias that introduces interaction at distance one, it is possible. So this is the plot of B is the bias parameter. So we recover the uniform measure when B is equal to one, and now the clustering transition is represented by the crosses. So you see that when you move B from the value one, you are able to increase the value of the clustering threshold, and the optimal value is found around B equals 0.4. And for this, we can obtain an increase of the third term of the asymptotic expansion. So we obtain gamma d is equal to 0.98, which has to be compared to the value for the uniform case, where gamma d is equal to approximately 0.87. Okay, so now I can conclude. So with this Bayesian measure, we were able to increase the value of the clustering threshold, both at small k and at large k. So at small k, we also check that this has indeed a positive impact on the performances of simulated annealing. And at large k, we could improve on the third term of the asymptotic expansion. So of course, the perspective now is it would be better to be able to improve on the more leading term of this asymptotic expansion, and to do that, we could try to use more generic bias. So first direction could be to try to increase the range of interaction, because here we have a look only at the interaction at distance one, but we could try to increase it. Also, we have only looked at the bias that only take the number of forcing clauses surrounding one variable, but it could be more general and carry more information. Okay, so thank you.
Okay,